Então, eu vou começar por falar um pouquinho sobre o conteúdo do curso. Esse curso tópico de sistemas dinâmicos não tem ementa fixa. A cada vez nós fixamos a ementa do ano. E esse ano eu vou falar sobre expoentes de Lyapunov. Eu estou. You understand Portuguese? Ok, let's. Alguém tem objeção a que eu dê aula em inglês? Em atenção aos nossos visitantes de fora? Podem fazer as perguntas em português se quiserem interromper, mas pode ser? Ok, so I'll proceed in English. Everyone is in agreement. So I will be talking about Lyapunov exponents. I'm going to define that in a little while. But the context is that I'm writing a book, actually almost finished, that is called Lectures. On Lyapunov exponents, and this will be the text that I will be following, and it is available on my website. If you want, you can download it directly from this address. And I will follow this text in the course. And what I will do today is talk about the very first chapter, where I kind of give an overview of the contents of the text. There will be no tests in this course, as usual, and. Everyone who attends the course will get a grade P, which means approval, approved. There are no tests and no seminars. Okay, what are Lyapunov exponents? I'm not going to define them immediately, but I'm going to give examples. And the simplest possible example is the following situation. You take certain number of matrices. These are matrices, and I'm going to consider always invertible matrices. D by D, square matrices, invertible. And we are going to consider the following process, where I choose one of these matrices. So B1 is a random variable. I choose them at random. Random variable with values in this set. I choose one of them. And of course, in order to speak of random variable, I have to say what the probability distribution is. So I'm going to assign to each one of these matrices a certain probability, P1, Pm, with probability distribution. Distribution given by P1, etc., Pn. What this means is that the probability of choosing the matrix Aj is Pj, is given by Pj. And then I want more than one random variable. I want several random variables. I want a sequence of random variables, all of them with these properties. So Bj, j equals 1, 2, etc. Form. I take random variables, all of them with this probability distribution given by the vector p1 pm. In other words, I choose one matrix at random with this probability distribution. Then I choose another one, then another one. I do this over and over again. And in order to complete the definition, I have to say a little bit more. I have to say, I'm going to ask that every time I choose a matrix that's independent of what I did before. So these matrices are independent random variables, these choices. Okay. So it is common to use this expression IID, where I stands for independence, and this stands for identically distributed. All of these matrices have the same probability. All of these choices have the same probability distribution. And then what we do with these choices is that we multiply them. It is usual to multiply them in this way, with the first one on the right and the last one on the left. You can do a completely dual theory by multiplying the other way around. Doesn't really matter. And this I'm going to call BN. This product. So each one of these matrices is a random variable, dependent random variable. So, of course, the product is also a random variable. And the general problem is, what can we say? What can we say about BN when N is large, when N goes to infinity? And, of course, since there's a random process here, there's a probability distribution here, we want to say things that make sense for, say, full probability. What can we say almost surely? This is a technical expression. It means for full probability for almost all choices of the successive matrices. Okay? So this is the general question that one wants to answer. And the theory started around 1960, 1959, 1960. I don't remember exactly. I think it's 1960, actually. With this, the following theorem. Which was proven by Furstenberg. By the way, the notion of Lyapunov exponent existed before. It was introduced by Lyapunov in the context of studying stability of differential equations. Of course, Lyapunov didn't call them Lyapunov exponents. The expression came later. But they were around in the work, classical work, in the ordinary differential equations of Furstenberg, where he was interested in stability, what we call Lyapunov stability of differential equations. But this is the first theorem that somehow says that these are well-defined, meaningful objects, not just tools to study stability. So the theorem of Furstenberg says, take the norm of these matrices. What is the norm of a matrix? The norm of A, I mean, there are many ways to define the norm, but the best one is the operator norm, which is apply A to a matrix, to a vector, take the norm of this vector, divide by the norm of the vector, and take the supremum over all non-zero vectors. Operator norm. But for the purpose of this theorem, it doesn't really matter how we define, because all norms in the space of matrices are equivalent, finite dimensional space. So take this, And then take logarithm and divide by n. The theorem of Furstenberg says that the limit as n goes to infinity exists almost surely. Okay? It's better than that. Let me call it. It's better than that. There exists some number that I'm going to call lambda plus, a real number, such that this limit is equal to lambda plus almost surely. So the limit exists, but more than that, it doesn't depend on the choices. For almost all choices of B1, B2, etc., what you get in the end as this limit is the same number. For those who are not used to seeing this kind of expression, what this means informally, what this means is that for n large, the norm of Bn is approximately, is approximately n, the exponential of n times lambda plus. Okay? That's what this means. So if by any for any reason you know that lambda plus is positive, this is telling you that the norm of these matrices is growing exponentially fast. And if you know that lambda plus is negative, then this means that the norm is decaying exponentially fast. The sign of the exponent tells you whether things are growing or decaying, and in any event, exponentially fast. I like to state this theorem with a second part, which is actually a consequence of the first one, but it's nice to state both explicitly. The second part is that there exists another number, lambda minus, such that the norm, as defined by this expression, is the maximum expansion that a vector may have under iteration by A. This is the supremum of this quotient here. There's a dual notion, which unfortunately doesn't have a very good notation, called the conorm. This is the norm, operator norm. There's a dual notion called operator conorm, that is defined to be the infimum of the same expression. This doesn't have a very good, the best notation I know is in the literature is this one, it's the conorm, infimum. So what this means geometrically, what this means is the following thing. You take your matrix, I'm drawing the picture in two dimensions, but this is general. You take the unit circle here, this is the unit sphere. You look at the image of the unit sphere, it's always an ellipsoid. In two dimensions, it's an ellipse. In higher dimensions, it's an ellipsoid. And those two numbers, the norm and the conorm, have the following geometric interpretation. The larger axis is the norm. And the smaller axis is the conorm. And if you are in higher dimension, you have D axis. The largest is the norm, the smallest is the conorm. Now, one of the reasons there's not a good notation for the conorm is that we don't really need a good notation for the conorm, because it is given by the following expression. And this is a small exercise. The conorm of a matrix is the inverse of the norm of the inverse. Exercise. One line exercise. Okay, so now I can finish the statement of the theorem. It says that there's a similar result for the conorm. So what I'm going to do today is that I'm going to state, at least in the first part, I'm going to state three theorems. This is the first one, theorem one. They are not the best theorems we have now. They are sort of the beginning statements. And then we'll spend some time in the course proving them, but also getting much stronger statements. And this is the very first theorem in the theory of Lyapunov exponents. That gives us these two numbers, lambda plus and lambda minus. We are going to, and these are Lyapunov exponents. They are our first Lyapunov exponents. Yes, okay, so that's my next topic. It is obvious from the definition, so a few remarks. It is obvious from the definition that the conorm is always smaller than the norm. This is the maximum amount of expansion, and this is the smallest one. So in particular, that's true for the matrix Bn here. So as a consequence, this is for every A. As a consequence, we have that lambda minus is always less or equal than lambda plus. First remark. Okay, so we will introduce a more general definition of Lyapunov exponents. There will be more Lyapunov exponents than just these two. And it will turn out that of all the Lyapunov exponents, this is the largest and this is the smallest. All the other ones are in between. Will be defined to be in between. Another simple observation, just linear algebra. If the determinant of A is 1, the determinant is the product of all the eigenvalues. So if the product is 1, then, maybe I should say this first. Let me say it in a slightly different order. The norm of A is bigger or equal than the absolute value of any eigenvalue of A. If you choose V to be an eigenvector, what you get here is the absolute value of the corresponding eigenvalue. Since the norm is a soup, it must be at least that. And for the same reason, the conorm is a lower bound for the absolute value of any eigenvalue. In particular, if the determinant is 1, then some eigenvalue must be bigger or equal than 1, and some eigenvalue must be smaller or equal than 1 in absolute value. So if the determinant is 1, then the norm is at least 1, and the co-norm is at most 1. Okay. And then, in that case, applying this simple observation to these products, we have that, remember, we have to take the logarithm and then divide by n. We have that lambda minus is negative and lambda plus is positive. Okay? So this is, maybe I should at this point introduce some notation. The space of invertible d by d matrices is the linear group G L D. I'm going to talk only about real matrices. Otherwise, I would have to distinguish between real coefficients and complex coefficients. And the space of invertible d by d matrices with determinant equals 1 is a special linear group SLD. Okay. So when all the matrices are in SLD, when all the matrices have determinant 1, then the two exponents are placed like this. They are actually a little exercise. Suppose that D is equal to 2, two-dimensional case. Okay. And all our matrices are in SL2. All our matrices have determinant 1. You take the unit circle, you apply your random matrix Bn, and you get, as I said, some ellipsoid, some ellipse in this case, in two dimension. And this gives you the co-norm of Bn, and this gives you the norm. The product of the two axes is related to the area of the circle. The area of the circle is related to the determinant of this matrix. So you should expect, and then each one of these gives rise to one of the two exponents. So you should expect that the two exponents, lambda plus and lambda minus, should be related to the Jacobian, to the determinant somehow. And that's what the exercise says. Then lambda plus lambda minus is equal to 0. Okay, so the theorem tells us that from a certain point of view, there is something very precise that we can say about these random products. At least in terms of the norm, they have very, and co-norm, They have very well-defined rates of growth, exponential growth, that, surprisingly enough, are independent of the choices. For almost all choices, you get the same number. And then these two numbers are related in this way. And in the special case of matrices with determinant 1, one can say much better. In this very special case, SL2, 2 by 2 matrices with determinant 1, the two numbers are symmetric. Okay? Questions? Almost surely, claro. So the question is, what does almost surely mean? So there's a space here. There's a product space that I'm going to present to make more explicit. Product space. Product probability space. So first of all, we have a set, which is the set of choices, of possible choices of matrices each time. These are the symbols that I have available. And on this set, we have a probability. P defined by, that's what I meant when I said that the probability distribution is given by this vector. The probability P in this space is defined in this way. The probability of the set AJ is PJ. This is a probability defined for every subset of this finite set, and it is defined in this way. But when we perform our process, we choose matrices on X an infinite number of times. So we actually have a sequence of matrices, right? So the space we are interested in is not this one. The space we are interested in is the space of sequences on X. So this is a space of sequences, alpha n, where each alpha n belongs to X. And what happens is that if you have a probability measure in a space, and then you take a product, there's a natural way of defining a product probability in the product space that I'm going to explain. Okay, so we also have a product measure which is a probability in M that I'm going to define. This is a general definition of product probability. So in order to define that, we need to consider certain subsets of this space that are called cylinders in M. I mean, there's a lot of notation, but the notions are rather natural. A cylinder is a subset like this, 0, then A I 0, a I 1, a I n, this is a notation for the kind of subsets that I want to introduce, and these A's are elements of X. So what is this? It is the set, the subset of sequences in M, such that the first one is equal to this matrix. The second one is equal to this matrix, and so on. So M is a space of sequences of matrices. If you prescribe which matrix you take first, which matrix you take second, and so on, for a certain finite number of steps, then the corresponding subset is called a cylinder. To define this product probability mu, I have to define it for all measurable subsets of M. The first step is to define it for cylinders. So by definition, mu of a cylinder well, what should it be? I want to include in the definition, to translate in the definition, the probability of choosing this matrix and then choosing this matrix and so on. Probability of choosing this one is PI0. The probability of choosing this one is PI1. And so on up to PIN. Okay? Now, let's be slightly careful here. This is the probability of choosing this one, and then of choosing this one, and so on. Why do I multiply these probabilities? I multiply because I assume that the random variables are independent. To say that they are independent is precisely to say that the probabilities multiply. Okay? Otherwise, we would have to do something different. So this defines the probability for certain subsets of M. And then there's a general statement, a proposition, saying that there exists a unique probability measure on the sigma algebra generated by the cylinders that satisfies this relation, that satisfies this. So what I call mu is the probability measure given by this proposition. And this has nothing to do with the present context. This is a measure theory statement. It's very general. It uses, you are defining here the measure on a certain set, a certain family of subsets of M, and then the extension theorem in measure theory tells you that under suitable conditions, this definition extends to the whole sigma algebra. Okay? So when I say, now I can answer your question, almost surely means for a set of sequences for a set of sequences alpha n in M with full, the total measure, with total mu measure. In other words, when I say that something is true almost surely, I mean that the set of sequences that do not satisfy the statement has zero measure for mu. Okay? Let's give an example, a couple of examples to get familiar with. So let's pick one example where M is two matrices, and the matrices are 2 by 2. I'm not going to make the calculations, but I'm going to try to convince you that of what the of the values of let's calculate these exponents. So the first example is this. We have two matrices. A1 is this one, and A2 is this one. And let's say that this has probability 1/2, and this also has probability 1/2. Okay? So we have a coin, we flip a coin. If we had heads, use this matrix. If we get tail, we use this matrix, and we just multiply them. This is a very simple example because both matrices are diagonal. And so when I calculate Bn, the product, it's very rare that you can do this, but in this case you can. You just multiply this coefficient and this coefficient. So what you get here is 3, let's say, times n1, 2 minus 1 times minus 2, 0, 0. Here 3 minus n, 3 to the n minus n1, 2n2, where n1 is the number of times you choose A1, and N2 is the number of times you choose A2. And of course, N1 plus N2 equals N. Notice that both matrices are in SL2. Okay, both of them have determinant 1. 2 by 2 matrices is determinant. So this is something that I can give you as an exercise to make precise what I'm explaining here. What do we expect? How does the norm of this vary? Of course, it depends on N1 and N2. For instance, if I always choose A1, if I never choose A2, in other words, if N2 is 0, then this grows, like this is 3 to the n, this is 3 to the minus n. The 3 to the n will give you the norm. The 3 to the minus n will give you the conorm. And you'll get that lambda plus is log of 3, and lambda minus is minus log of 3. But the set of choices where you always choose A1 has measure 0. So it's irrelevant. So I'm not answering the question. What do we expect about these two numbers, N1 and N2? Each matrix has probability 1/2. So you expect that N1 and N2 should be approximately the same. Statistically. More precisely, and this is a theorem, this is called the law of large numbers. You know by the law of large numbers that N1 divided by N converges to 1/2, and n2 divided by n converges to 1/2. Okay? So let's be slightly non-rigorous here. Let's pretend that the two numbers are equal. Then here you have 3 divided by 2. So when n1 equals n2, this is 3/2 to n over 2, 0, 0, 2/3 to n over 2. Right? I'm not saying that n1 is equal to n2. I'm saying that they must be more or less of the same order, so we can use this little bit of cheating to guess what the result is. So this would lead us to think that this term grows like 3/2 to n over 2, and this decay is like 2/3 to the n over 2. So if this were true, then we would have as lambda plus 1 over n logarithm of this. 1 over n logarithm of this gives 1/2 of logarithm of 3/2. Okay? And of course, then lambda minus would be minus 1/2 logarithm, 1/2 logarithm of 2/3. Okay? Exercise. Check rigorously that this is correct. Proof. I didn't prove it, because in this yellow thing that I wrote here, I pretended that n1 and n2 is equal. That's not true. If you throw a coin 1 billion times, it's not going to come out exactly 1/2 a billion head and 1/2 a billion tail. But the error is so small that makes this calculation actually give the right results. Okay? So for this example, you see, the two matrices are trying to fight each other. This one wants to expand vectors in the horizontal axis and contract the other ones. This one does exactly the opposite, contracts the horizontal, expands the vertical. And, well, that one is stronger because the 3 is larger than 2. And in the end, you get this. Okay? But I'm also giving this as an example to answer your question. What means almost surely? If you always choose a 1, of course, you're not going to get that rate of growth or decay. But always choosing always a 1 is zero measure. It's extremely unlikely. Okay? If you are in a casino and the guy flips a coin and you get 17 times, and you lose 17 times in a row, then you start to suspect that it's not a very fair game. This is all about fair games. Another example. This one is a little bit trickier. It's a nice example of Kiefer. Again, with two matrices. A1 is, for example, the same one as in there. A2 is the rotation. A1 is the same matrix. A2 is the rotation of 90 degrees. Takes E1 and sends it to E2. Right?
E1 goes to E2, the vector, the basis of R2. And it takes E2 and sends it to minus E1. Now, this is an example that it's much easier to understand by yourself than to explain. Let me try to explain with my hands. I want to understand the norm of Bn in this case. So the norm has to do with how much vectors grow. Ah, I forgot on purpose. Probability here is 1 minus delta, and here is delta. And I'm not saying who is delta. Okay, but it will be small. Now, so if you want to try to understand the behavior of the norm has to do with how much vectors grow or decay in the iterations. So it might be complicated to do that for all vectors, but let's start. There are obvious choices in this example because the two axes are invariant, are eigenspaces, right, for this matrix, and not really eigenspaces for this matrix. But the rotation of 90 degrees exchanges the two axes. So in any event, the set formed by the two axes is invariant by both matrices, right? So let's start with a vector that is horizontal. Let's flip a coin and see what happens. And let's suppose, just for the sake of argument, that in the first 17 times, we get A1. So what happens to this vector? At each time, it is multiplied by 3. So it grows very fast, okay? But since we are doing things almost surely, sooner or later, we will not choose A1. Sooner or later, by flipping the coin, we will get the other matrix, A2. And then what happens to this vector? It just moves to the vertical direction. And then we have another streak of choices of A1, say 20 more choices, and the coin somehow gives us A1. And what happens to this vector now? It grew, it was multiplied by 3, but while it remains in the vertical, it will be divided by 3. So the matrix A1 is itself destroying what it did before. However, sooner or later, we will get an A2, and the vector will go back to horizontal, and the whole thing will start all over again. Now, so this vector, this particular vector that I chose, will grow a factor of 3 per iteration during the time it remains horizontal. And it will decay at factor 1/3 per iteration during the time it will remain vertical. Now we have to think, is it going to spend more time lying down or standing up? The same. Most likely the same. So, this vector is essentially not going to grow at all. This requires a proof, but it can be done. And the proof is, the statement is, that the same is true for all vectors, and lambda plus is actually equal to 0. Equal to lambda minus. I'm not saying I proved it. I didn't. But I gave you elements that can be transformed into a proof. The amount of time, the fraction of time that your vector spends vertically or horizontally is the same. It's 50% of the time. And as a consequence, there is no growth. Same thing for if I start with a vector that is vertical. And once you know that horizontal and vertical do not grow, then no vector grows. Okay? There's only one thing in what I said that is not 100% correct. which is that I said sooner or later we will have to use A2. Sooner or later. It may take a long time, because if delta is very small, say if delta is 1 millionth, I will get to use A2 only once in a million times, which is okay for my argument. I only said sooner or later. But if delta is zero, then it's different. When I said sooner or later, I assumed that delta is positive, which of course one always believes that delta is positive. But it's interesting to think of what happens if delta is zero. Then my argument collapses. If delta is zero, you have probability zero of finding A2. It's the same thing as saying that you are not allowed to use this matrix. Then you only use this one. It's not really random anymore. It's just multiplying this matrix over and over and over again. It's always the same matrix. It will grow like 3 each time, and the co-norm like 1/3. So in that case, lambda plus is log 3, and lambda minus is minus log 3, it's log 1/3. Okay? In these examples, these calculations can be done rigorously. I think they are actually stated as exercises in the text, but that's not my point. Here I want to convince you intuitively that these are the results. Okay, I'll come back to this example in a little while. Now, more questions? Exactly this context. Except that they were not. I'm focusing a lot more on the two-dimensional cases, which they didn't. But otherwise, this is the context. They were interested. You're right. In a more general setup of Lie groups. Their game was more abstract. We are dealing here with some special Lie groups, the linear group, the special linear group, and they were interested in a lot more. But what the paper contains, as far as I remember, I might be wrong, is for these choices of for the linear case. Well, I could make a break here to say why Lyapunov was interested, why Lyapunov created the notion of Lyapunov exponents. He was as I mentioned, he was interested in ordinary differential equations, and more precisely the following kind of situation that you find in textbooks in differential equations. You have a differential equation of this form. Where this is a matrix, a non-autonomous linear differential equation. Okay? Then V constant equal to zero is a solution. This equation. Let me write it like this. This is time. So the solution that is constant equal to the origin the curve, the constant curve, is a solution. And Lyapunov wanted to characterize when the solution is stable. Stable meaning that solutions that start nearby approach this one, or at least remain close to this one. At least don't get far away. That's what's one calls Lyapunov stability. So he first observed that you take the Lim soup, of, let me see, okay, what do I have to, okay. The theory of differential equations says that there exists some matrix function such that the solution of the equation that with initial condition V0, here, let me write it like this, V, and I put the T up here, with a certain initial condition is V of T equals phi T applied to V naught. I think in the books this is called the fundamental solution of the equation, or something like that. There's a matrix valued function such that if you want to know the solution of the equation with a certain initial condition, then this is given by this one. For example, if A is constant, is independent of T, this is just the exponential. Okay. Now, this is absolutely basic differential equations. Now, the zero solution is, the zero curve is the solution, and you want to know if it is stable. Now, this is not a difficult thing. What Lyapunov did was to define this function lambda of V equal Lim sup as T goes to infinity, 1 over n log phi T V. The resemblance to the definition of the Lyapunov exponents is clear, I think. He wrote Lim sup because he didn't know whether the limit exists. And another difference is that this is a differential equation. Time is continuous. So defined this way. And then Lyapunov says if lambda V is less than zero for all V, so if this norm decays, then the solution is stable. Then V equals zero is a stable solution. Now, this is not a brilliant theorem. This is not the main result of Lyapunov. It's more like an observation. If these exponents here are negative, then the zero is a stable solution. So what is the big theorem of Lyapunov? He was not interested in linear equations. He was interested in general equations. He was interested in perturbations of that, where you have an additional term. You have to choose the right notation. Yeah. An additional term. And you wanted to know whether zero is a stable solution for this one. So. Now take another equation, a nonlinear equation. Perturbation. With this condition here, this is remains a solution. The same, and this is the question Lyapunov asked. All that stability means that solutions that start nearby remain nearby, don't get far. So you think of that equation as being a small perturbation of this one. For values close to zero, this error term is small. Is the solution still stable? And then that's the theorem of Lyapunov. The theorem is yes. Yes, if lambda v is less than zero for all v, the same lambda defined here, and the equation is regular. There's an additional hypothesis in the theorem that I'm not going to define, but I will come back to that later on when we get to the right point. Lyapunov had no way of checking whether a given equation is regular or not. He only noticed that he needed this extra condition. And when time comes, I will come to this and I will explain what this means. But it's not. It's a very technical condition and very difficult to check in specific condition, in specific equations. Okay, so this is a little bit of history of why exponents were introduced in the first place and why they are named after Lyapunov. Okay, let's move on to the next topic. The next question, as we saw, lambda minus is always less or equal than lambda plus. So the question I want to discuss next is when are they equal. When are they equal? The theorem is due to Furstenberg a few years later. And his answer, in a nutshell, is almost never. But I'm going to be a bit more precise. For example, here is a counterexample. This is a situation where the two exponents are equal. Okay. However, this is also a very special kind of choice of matrices. For example, this matrix is hyperbolic. That's not special. It has its eigenspaces. This matrix doesn't have eigenspaces, but somehow it was chosen so carefully that it takes one eigenspace of A1 and maps it into another eigenspace of A1, and the other way around. So almost never in the theorem of Furstenberg means essentially this kind of phenomenon. For lambda plus and lambda minus to be equal, it is necessary that the matrix, the various matrices, must be in agreement a lot about lots of things. For example, they must share, all of them, the same eigenspace. Or, as in this example, they don't have eigenspaces in common, but one preserves the set of eigenspaces of the other. That's what almost never means. But I'm going to make this precise through the following notions. So we have these matrices, A1, A2, AM. And I'm going to consider the monoid associated to this family of matrices, defined by what the monoid is just an expression for the set of words that you can form with these matrices. So the set of all products A1, AN, or alpha 1, alpha N, with alpha 1, alpha N in A. Monoid means I think when I was in school, monoids were called semigroups. It's almost the same thing as a group, except that you don't have the inverse. There's a multiplication. Semigroup with unity. With unity elements. So you have a multiplication. The multiplication is associative. There's a neutral element, and that's it. So what is the operation? What is the multiplication in the monoid? In order to multiply alpha 1, alpha n by beta 1, beta m, well, you just multiply them. You concatenate. And the monoid defined by A is just all those products that you can construct with these matrices. The unit element is the empty words. The empty word is the identity. So this is a convention. The identity is the empty word. In this. So here N is bigger or equal than zero. If it is zero, means the empty word, and the empty word is the, by convention, the identity. Okay. So if I give you a certain number of matrices, invertible, it's not so important, but I'm only working with invertible matrices. You can take all those, the set of all the products of those matrices, possibly repeating and so on. And that's the monoid generated by the set A. Now, I want to define. No, that's not a group. That would be the group generated by A. This is a semigroup. The difference is precisely that there are no inverses. Okay? This is a semigroup generated. There are no inverses here. this example, for instance, it's not difficult to see what the it's not difficult to calculate the monoid explicitly to see what matrices come up. So we say that a monoid is pinching. Now here, for simplicity, for today, I'm going to suppose that D equals 2. Two-dimensional matrices. the two notions that I'm going to introduce, pinching and twisting, make sense in any dimension, but it's more complicated to define them in higher dimensions. We say that B is pinching if for every constant C, there exists some element of the monoid such that the norm of B divided by the conorm is bigger than C. So geometrically, what does this mean? It means that you choose any constant, arbitrarily large, and then you can find some element in the monoid that has the following behavior. You take the unit disk, the unit circle. It is mapped by B to an ellipse. In this ellipse, the axis, the large semi-axis, is the norm. The small semi-axis is the conorm. And you are saying that this is much bigger than this one. Okay? Pardon? Oh, yeah. But for smaller than one, this is automatic. But yeah, this is relevant when C is big. So one way to remember this is to say that pinching means that there exist elements in the monoid with arbitrarily large eccentricity. You can speak of the eccentricity of a matrix. It's just the eccentricity of this ellipse that is the image of the unit circle. And you want to have in your monoid elements with arbitrarily large eccentricity. Okay? Condition number one, pinching. For example, the monoid generated by these two matrices here is pinching. How can I find elements in this monoid that have large eccentricity? Well, I don't count very much on the rotation. Rotations don't create eccentricity. I should count on this one. And it's clear that this already has some eccentricity because the unit circle goes to an ellipse that looks like this, where this is 3 and this is 1/3. That's already some eccentricity. But I want arbitrarily large eccentricity. Well, it's easy. Take the powers of A1. All the powers of A1 are in the monoid, and they have arbitrarily large eccentricity because then the quotient will be 9 to the n. Okay? So this monoid here is pinching. Exercise. Or perhaps it's too easy for an exercise, but it's good to state it. Remember, I'm only talking about the two-dimensional case right now. So remark, if some aj is hyperbolic, then the monoid is pinching. Hyperbolic means we are talking about 2x2 matrices. Hyperbolic means that the matrix has two real eigenvalues and they are different. Like 3 1/3. The largest eigenvalue will make the norm grow. The smallest eigenvalue will not let the co-norm grow as fast. So the quotient between the two decreases exponentially faster. Another example. Two matrices. One is this one. The other is this one. And B is the monoid generated by them. It is pinching. Now, you cannot use my previous observation because these two matrices are not hyperbolic. You have seen these matrices in linear algebra. They are Jordan blocks. This matrix has one, that's the unique eigenvalue. And it has, the eigenspace is one-dimensional. This one, the same thing. There's a unique eigenvalue, one. And the eigenspace is one-dimensional. Here, the eigenspace is the horizontal axis. Here is the vertical. So these two matrices are parabolic. Parabolic matrices have real eigenvalues that are equal. Real eigenvalues with multiplicity 2. These are both parabolic. Nevertheless, B is pinching. That's not entirely obvious. You have to sit down with a piece of paper and a pencil and start drawing pictures and see if there's eccentricity being created, large eccentricity. And then in the middle of doing that, you realize that if you multiply A1 by A2, that gives two, one, one, one. And this is a hyperbolic matrix. You calculate this is the cat map. This is a hyperbolic matrix, and A1, A2 isn't a monoid, of course. So you see, getting pinching is not very difficult. On the contrary, it's very easy. If you have some hyperbolic matrix in your monoid, you have pinching. Otherwise, maybe multiplying, you can find one, and so on. There are many ways you can get this condition. Any example of a monoid that is not pinching? take 17 rotations. If you multiply two rotations, the product is a rotation. The set of rotations is a group. And rotations don't have, rotations send the unit circle to the unit circle. They don't have eccentricity at all. Okay. Second notion is the following. We say that the monoid is twisting if for any lines, a line is a one-dimensional subspace. For any lines V W1 WL R2 there exists some element of the monoid such that B of V intersection WJ is 0 for all J. So what does this mean? You have a bunch of straight lines, of lines, W1, W2, W3, so on. Yeah, and you have one that I'm distinguishing somehow. For example, this one, V. And this, my picture, V is equal to W1. And to say that the monoid is twisting is to say that there is some element in the monoid that takes V and maps it outside sends it to a line that is in transverse to all the other ones. Okay? Let's check two examples. Is this monoid twisting, the one generated by these two? I'm going to suggest that you take here V, the x-axis, W1, the x-axis, and W2, the y-axis. Is there any element of the monoid generated by these two matrices that takes V and sends it neither to W1 nor to W2? No. This one doesn't change V at all, this matrix. This one either sends V to W1 or this one sends V to W2. And by multiplying them, you can never find any element in the monoid that does this trick here. So the monoid generated by these two is not twisting. Okay? What about this one? If we were talking about the axis, only for the axis, that's fine. This one doesn't change the horizontal axis, but it does change the vertical axis and maps it to something that is not neither horizontal nor vertical. This one does the opposite. You have to work a little bit, but that's an exercise. Exercise this monoid is twisting. So the theorem of Fürstenberg, he didn't state it like that, but it's equivalent. Just a reformulation. Says that if the monoid is pinching and twisting, then lambda minus is strictly smaller than lambda plus. So what kind of situations, what this theorem is saying ideologically, is that in words, it is saying that if lambda minus is equal to lambda plus, then either there is no eccentricity, or there is a coincidence. This is complicated to say. It's much easier to understand. But I'm going to explain it. Eigenspaces. So to explain that, I'm just going to write here two examples where the exponents are equal, and to relate that to what I just wrote. So two examples. The first matrix is a rotation, two rotations. This means cosine theta 1 minus sine theta 1, sine theta 1, cosine theta 1. Same thing here. So in this example, the exponents are both 0, because when you multiply rotations, it doesn't matter how you multiply them, the product is a rotation. And for rotations, the norm and the co-norm don't grow at all. Okay, so the exponents are equal. And the guilty character, the reason, is that the monoid is not pinching. No one creates eccentricity in this monoid. All the matrices are just rotations. They send the unit circle to the unit circle. And there's no eccentricity as here. Well, I already erased. And the other example is, well, the same that is over there. In this case, as we observed, V is pinching. V is pinching. This matrix here creates eccentricity. This matrix and its powers have a norm that is much bigger than the co-norm. So there's eccentricity. However, it is not twisting. the coincidence of eigenspaces that I wrote there in quotation marks means that the two matrices agree that the eigenspaces of this one should be preserved. This A1 fixes its eigenspaces, A2 permutes them, but they agree to leave, and that kills twisting. You cannot take, as I observed before, you cannot take the horizontal axis and send it into general position with respect to the two axes. Okay. So this is Furstenberg's theorem in an equivalent formulation to his theorem in dimension two. The theorem, in fact, extends to arbitrary dimension, and that's something that we are going to exploit. It extends in more than one way. It has been generalized in more than one way, and that's another theme that I want to exploit here. And to conclude, the last thing that I want to say today is, that I want to discuss is the question of continuity. Pinching is necessary. Pinching is definitely necessary. Twisting is not necessary. For example, if I have only one matrix, a stupid example, but if I have only one matrix that's hyperbolic, then of course the norm grows as the largest exponent, the conorm grows as the smallest, so they will be different. But with only one matrix, there's no twisting. Cannot be. Because the eigenspaces of that matrix are, with one hyperbolic matrix, are invariant. Okay, but you're right. Pinching is necessary. That's more or less obvious because the norm of Bn has to grow like e to the n lambda plus the conorm like e to the n lambda minus. This is bigger than this one. This is the large semi-axis. This is small semi-axis. So for any large n, this will already have large eccentricity. Okay. All the matrices that you find here are in the monoid. Okay. Okay. Last topic for today is continuity. As I said, this is an overview of the contents of the text, and then we will come back to these topics to expand them in various ways. Continuity is the following question. We have data to our problem that are these matrices. We also have, as part of the data, the probabilities that each one of them has. And then given this data, we found a number, actually two numbers, lambda plus and lambda minus, that are functions of these data. So it is quite natural to ask, how regular are these functions? Well, in principle, I'm not sure I will be able to explain today why, but in principle, we should not expect much. The There's a quote that I like very much by Felix Klein, where he says that, unlike what most people think, not every function in nature is real analytic. Which is a strange quote. I'm not sure most people have a thought about that. But this is essentially the same here. It's not because you define a function that it will be well behaved. And Lyapunov exponents, to begin with, the theorem that says that these numbers exist is only almost surely. It's not for all choices. And if you start to ask how does that limit depend on the choice, it's absolutely a mess. It's a miracle that for almost all choices we have a constant. If we go beyond that set of full measure, then it's a mess. This theory thinks functions, when they are good, they are measurable. When they are measurable, you are already very happy. So one should not expect much in general, because this is a measurable world, not much better than that. Also, there's there's a set of ideas that were developed in the beginning by Ricardo Manier. They are also part of the text, and I hope to be able to talk about them. This was around 1983. He was not dealing with this situation. He was dealing with related situations. I cannot be precise at this point. I will try to do that later on. But his discovery, his claim, suggests that one should expect discontinuous behavior. I cannot be more precise than this, but you can check the text. It's chapter 9 in the text. As I said, he was dealing with a slightly different but related setting, and what he observed is that continuous behavior of numbers like these only happens in very special situations. So the expectations should not be very high, but nevertheless, in this setting, one does have continuity. So, and that's the third result that we are going to work on. These functions, so the functions this is for dimension 2, and this was done by Carlos Bocher in his thesis. For dimension 2, these two functions are continuous at all points. There are many results in this direction. Furstenberg and Kiefer I'm sure they would not agree with me when I say that they did the easy case. That was 30 years ago. What they did then looks very easy now. For certain choices of the matrices, certain assumptions. Also, there's a later paper by Yuval Peres saying, again, in the easy case, these functions are analytic. that was after and using very different methods. So, yeah. Yeah, I said we would come back to this example, right? You see, I told you one should not expect much because this is a measurable world where measurability is already very good. You should not expect much because of Meunier's results, and you should not expect much because of this example. Look at this example. Lambda plus is log 3 when delta is 0. But when delta is slightly positive, lambda plus is 0. So there's a clear case of discontinuity here. Right? I'm saying that the functions are continuous in terms of the coefficients and the also the probabilities, this joint continuity, the strong statement. So the reason this is not a counterexample is that I have to be precise about where these things vary. This varies in GL2, so invertible 2x2 matrices, and this varies in the space of vectors P1, Pm, such that Pj is positive for all j, and the sum P1 plus Pm equals 1. Okay, so the answer, Maurice, is that the domain where you should take these p's to vary is the open simplex. I don't allow p to go to 0. None of these coefficients to go to 0, because otherwise I will get this kind of counterexample. So this this example is quite handy because it's a simple elementary example that gives you a little glimpse of why of the fact that the problem is delicate. Already here we have a discontinuity. And what I call the easy case of Furstenberg-Kiefer is when you assume that the matrices don't have a common eigenspace. That the matrices don't admit one line that is invariant by all of the matrices, which is already the typical case. I call it easy because I want to make a little bit of propaganda, but because the other case is much harder to handle, but it's already the typical case. Okay, but turns out that it's continuous at all points. These numbers are continuous at all points. And that's something that my goal in the course is to give at the end a proof of this theorem. And we'll see in the meantime what we are able to prove as intermediate steps. More questions? Okay, I think we can stop here. It's already quite a lot for today. So what I told you corresponds